Unlocked is brought to you by Invincible, a program designed to unlock the potential of people and teams inside your organization. Join companies like Pfizer, Delta, the CDC, Google, and Chick-fil-A, and others in over 116 countries that are currently using this program to increase productivity and develop healthy cultures. Access hundreds of hours of content that is accessible anytime, anywhere. And finally, use real-time data to understand the health of every team inside your organization, which teams are performing and which ones aren't. Then understand the why behind that performance. Get free access to Invincible for 30 days by visiting www.giant.tv/30days. Hello, welcome to another episode of Unlocked. Today, we're going to talk about caring. And we're talking about that with Patrick Broccolo, who is the COO and co-owner of Senior One Care. And this is one of the largest companies like this in the nation. And it's really cool. Their model's really cool. I wanted to feature Patrick on the show because of what he's doing to not only unlock his own people, but unlock the community that he's serving through unlocking his own people. So Patrick has a really cool mindset about this. He's not just concerned about his business, his people. He's concerned about the broader community and the impact that it has, because that's kind of the nature of his business, is to take care of people in the community. And doing that through, yes, direct services that they provide, but also the way his employees go out and then in the future make an impact. He feels responsible for that. And that's really, really beautiful. So you're going to learn about that. You're going to learn about the school, his model for some things there. That's really cool. I don't want to spoil it for you, but it's really fun. Good conversation I had with Patrick. So get ready. Here we go. Patrick, it is so good to have you on the show today. How's it going?
Good, good. How are you doing? Thanks for having me.
Yeah, so good. It's beginning to be springtime. And so, you know, pollen is blowing up and we are all getting allergies. So it's all good.
That's right. Well, I wore my yellow. I'm trying to bring spring sooner rather than later. So
well played. Well played.
Yeah.
Hey, we've got something to talk about today. You and I spoke a little while ago, and I really loved your passion about not only the profession you're in of caregiving, but the angle you throw towards culture and what that means. Caregiving isn't just your profession, it's caregiving for the people that you're also leading and that you're trying to build up there. You're leading one of the largest caregiving organizations in the nation. Tell us how you got to this point, first of all. How did you land where you are? Because it's not a normal path.
Yeah, sure. Well, thanks again for inviting me. I appreciate you and your show a lot of the content that you're bringing out there is great for us. My story begins, I went to college here in Indianapolis, which is where I'm located now at Butler University, and really had a passion for sales and marketing. I just liked being around people and really gravitated towards that. Had a really fun career in sales and marketing, worked for newspapers and those kinds of things, and learned a lot about content and media sales and talking to your customers and those kinds of things. I got married to my beautiful wife, long story short, unfortunately, my mother-in-law got diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. And so we were going up helping take care of her. And I just had I wasn't really good at it. I didn't know what I was doing. And when she went on hospice, this home health aide came in and started providing home care to her. And man, that hit me hard because it really reduced her stress level, you know, in that difficult situation, as well as us. And, you know, she was calling me the outlaw again instead of the in-law and those kinds of things. But, you know, it really was kind of a calling for me to want to go and get into healthcare. And at the time, my in-laws had started senior one care up in the northern part of the state. And so all these things just kind of happened at once. So made a crazy move and basically completely switched professions and jumped into the healthcare field, not knowing much about that. So that's kind of how it started, and opened up a branch down here. And before I opened up here, I actually took a job in the nursing home. I went and became a certified nurse aide. So I actually learned the skills of how to assist people safely, and really learn some of the needs that our potential customers could need, as well as our other customers, which is our employees, our direct care staff, our caregivers. So, you know, you mentioned earlier, Skot, from a culture perspective, we feel like we have two clients, the ones we serve and the ones we employ. And I think they really intermingle together to have a really positive end result of quality care.
So those people that you brought on, how easy has it been to fill these positions and to retain them?
The million-dollar question. I think you know, we're still learning about that. But what I would say is, first of all, I truly believe we're all wired to help other people. It's just in our DNA. We just do it in different ways, and so the challenge is, if you will, is almost a branding, you know, messaging point, where this is actually a profession you can get paid for, is to help other people. So getting that out has been, you know, part of it. And then when you see, you know, keeping them here, you know, there's a lot of emotions that are there when you're changing someone's life. You're really helping them become actually more independent than dependent on a caregiver. And so part of that is we felt, hey, let's really invest in training for individuals. And we actually started our own certified nurse aide training school almost 10 years ago to have kind of that next level of education for our caregivers, so that, you know, obviously they can provide better care, but they're developing themselves, you know. And that's a real key for us in our company, is to really promote this continuing learning behavior, you know, and always wanting to get better and always wanting to find another way to, you know, make someone's day. And so if we continue to do that, you know, it's hard to leave. It's hard to not want to take care of that special someone, that client that you've been taking care of for so long.
So you're investing in them. In return, they're thanking you with loyalty and sticking around, right? They sense that, hey, you're investing in me, my continuous improvement and education, and, you know, that's helping me feel like you care.
Absolutely. You know, a certain percentage of our caregivers are actually, I would just call them healthcare students. So they're going to school in some form of healthcare, you know, nursing is a big one, et cetera. And on top of all of that, Skot, you know, we're actually helping them become better clinicians in the future, because they're learning the human aspect, the family dynamics, the environments of which they live, that are outside the walls of your typical healthcare settings right now. And so in those respects, Skot, we feel that the turnover actually isn't a bad thing. It's a stepping stone for their career. So you know, if you're in college today, I'd much rather you work in home care if you're becoming a nurse than going out and working in a restaurant or a retail store, which you can, it can gain a lot of knowledge there. But, you know, this is an opportunity for you to see, you know, what healthcare is all about, you know, when people go home or the doctor's not there. And to me, I think in the future, that's just going to pay dividends for that person. So there is such a thing, I think, as good turnover.
I don't hear that very often right now, Patrick. People are like, good turnover. What is that? I mean, when you talk about turnover, it's like, hey, how's your turnover right now? Which is always a problem.
Yeah.
You know, it's especially when I'm going in and talking with leaders and cultures and trying to shape team communication, and turnover is a reflection of a bad culture.
Sure.
That's the way it's seen. So why, like, tell me about this. Like, I'm curious, like, when did this happen? When did this all of a sudden switch? And you're like, huh, this turnover thing, actually, I'm seeing that as a good thing.
Sure. Sure. You know, I think first of all, you don't want people to leave your company. But if you know why they're leaving, you know, it just kind of puts another reflection on why they are. If they are going on to get into a healthcare profession, because technically what we do is all non-medical in nature. You know, we're not administering medication, but we're helping remind you of your medication. That's a good thing. You know, because in the end, they actually become future referral sources for us is one way to look at it. But the things you just mentioned there, you know, communication with your team, we are uber focused on that right now. And we have to. We have to continue to look at those things to improve the turnover that we don't want to happen. You know, the things that we can control, we need to look at those things and make it a better experience for our employees as well. So it's almost two different groups of folks that we're looking at.
So why do you see training as such a vital component in this non-medical world, right? Right. This idea came around 10 years ago. Why? Like, do other people not do this?
Yeah, no, it's a good question. You know, technically in non-medical home care, you don't need technically any specific training to do what you do. We all can assist people with non-medical everyday tasks, you know, getting dressed and combing your hair and getting a ride to the grocery store and those types of things. Just what we found was, and as all things with healthcare, a lot of the care needed had to have been happening in a prevention state, where typically it's happening in a reactive state, right? It's after the fall. And so we thought, wow, wouldn't it be neat if we had trained individuals who could help prevent some of those unnecessary hospital stays, as an example, or those unnecessary accidents. And so We were one of the leaders, I feel, in really going all in on finding, you know, that highly qualified training person, caregiver, to do this work. And then we kind of doubled down on it, Scott. And we just said, we're going all in on it, and let's create our own training school to not only help us from a recruiting standpoint, but a lot of these individuals are going and they're working on currently in our nursing homes today, you know. And so It's giving back to the community is what we're really, really focused on.
That's a really cool way to think about it. And because it's really easy to get siloed into your thing, right? And to be concerned with your goals and your objectives and your people. But I hear you thinking of a broader impact of what you are contributing to and being part of. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And hopefully it's a reminder on our culture side. So it comes full circle that, you know, we're all contributing to this. Every team member is doing that. And look, caregivers are they're elite. I would put them up against any other group out there. They're doing unbelievable things. If I could tell you all these stories, we wouldn't have enough time, but But every person in our organization contributes to that somehow, you know, whether it's receiving a phone call from a client, whether it's our customer we serve or caregiver we serve, how do we address that? That's all part of the experience, this culture that Senior One has.
So describe a typical caregiver to me. Like, and what are they doing? And
sure.
What's the impact that they're having?
Yeah. You know, well, we talked about one type of caregiver we have, which is, I would say, like a medical student, you know, someone who's learning to be a clinician, and they just want more experience. But I'll tell you, a typical person is usually someone who enjoys people. That doesn't mean they have to be extroverted or introverted. It's they enjoy impacting people, but they don't even know that this profession exists. So many times you'll see they work in retail or restaurant. You know, I was sitting in a drive-thru the other day at Panera Bread, and it took a really long time to get to the window because they were short-staffed, obviously. And, you know, you've been there, you know, you wait and you're just expecting not a happy person. And I couldn't tell you how happy this person was. She's like, how are you doing? You know, she's trying to distract me from the fact that I've been waiting for, you know, a long time for the meal. And I was just blown away at just her glow and her excitement of, you know, wanting to talk to people, you know. And to me, and I told her this, I said, you need to come work at Senior One Care. You need to help people out there who right now are, you know, they're in their homes. They may be isolated. They're not able to drive out. And you know, that client feels like they're a burden because they're dependent on somebody else. And you know, what's really neat, Scott, is when the caregiver, when there's a good match, we're actually helping them become more independent. We can actually go and do things and see people and have experiences. And so the type of people are those who really want to make a difference. You know, they're sitting right now saying, look, I love my job. And I'm kind of one of those people. I love my job in sales and marketing. But what I loved about it was the people I worked with and the people I get to see every day. And man, I'd love to make that impact on another person. And so we really are changing lives here because we're just improving their quality of life. And my favorite phone call, Scott, is from a client. They'll call inevitably and they'll say, Patrick, you know, your caregiver is exceptional. They're just really dependable. And I, you know, I really like them coming around. I wish I knew about you guys sooner, you know? And so if anything, you know, my call out is, caregiving is for you. If that's something that you want to make an impact in someone's life, we'll teach you how to do the skills, no problem. But if you have that heart to really make a difference, it doesn't have to be full-time. It can be part-time, it can be flexible. And boy, the world will be a better place because of it, I think.
So how have you grown so fast? Are there just more and more people just getting old and need more help? I mean, what's your secret sauce? Help us.
Yeah, I think, you know, the quick answer is yes. Today, 10,000 people turn 65 in this country. Just today.
Today? And
that's today.
That's a lot of people.
And that's happened every single day this year for the last 4 or 5 years. And that's going to continue for the next 15 years. So, you know, you're talking about the baby boomer generation. And, you know, because of some unbelievable medical marvels that we have in this country, we're living longer and more chronically. And so the need is out there and it's rapidly picking up. And much like what we talk about in the workforce side, there's probably not enough people that could take care of everything and everybody. And so statistics are there to help the growth, but I truly believe how we handle problems specifically quickly and that we address them and we work together as a team to find solutions has really built up our, you know, professional reputation that it's all word of mouth, Scott. We don't do any advertising for our company. And it's because of the quality of the individual that's walking into that house. And so we're attracting people to work here because we have availability, you know, to work here. We're pretty flexible. We've got a great team that are working and supporting those caregivers. You know, it all kind of works together to do that. And at the same time, we got to continuously improve. We got to look at the ways that we do business and support our teams, you know, and the market drives that. You know, we're looking at inflation and gas prices right now. How can we assist our team members in doing that? How can we flex to make it, again, a quality experience for that individual?
So I just also heard you say, I mean, I'm like throwing in my own words here, Patrick, but you embrace, quote unquote, turnover, right? The right kind of turnover that helps you feel like you've contributed and that you're contributing to a greater cause. But I also heard you just say that you kind of embrace conflict as well. Mm-hmm. So these are two things that typically people don't want. They're trying to avoid conflict. They're trying to avoid turnover in all aspects, but you tend to embrace these things. So tell me about the conflict thing. What's that about?
Yeah, conflict is usually negative viewed in nature. And so there's a hesitancy to have conflict. So teams become, I think we can become complacent that way unintentionally, just because, you know, like in our work, it's a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week thing. So we're putting out a lot of fires and we're supporting people quickly. And so the more conflict you have, though, we're benefiting from your gifts and talents, you know, because it's coming from a place of experience and knowledge that when you put a team together, you have a pretty sharp tool to use, you know, to solve a problem or change things. One of those was our school. We were sitting around there saying, we saw a problem 10 years ago with a lack of workforce. You know, a lot of the groups that were out there weren't teaching, you know, certified nurse aide training for a variety of reasons. And we said, well, how are we going to fix this? And, you know, the quick version was, we shouldn't be starting a school. We have no idea how to start a school or build a school. And others said, we need to start a school. And so the conflict came together and voila, we created Legacy CNA Training. So really neat things can come out of that. Conflict is not yelling and screaming at each other, although it can get loud because you're bringing your opinions together. But until you have that conflict, you're never really going to have buy-in, because it's easy not to say anything, leave the room, and then, you know, not have a buy-in into what the next step is. And you need the full team support in all departments and all angles to really, I think, succeed.
And when we don't have the conflict, that is usually, the root cause is usually a lack of confidence or psychological safety in that space, right? So if we feel afraid to bring up conflict or to defend an idea or to challenge your idea, then that's usually because I don't feel safe enough doing that. I either feel like I'm going to be bulldozed, or maybe I just don't care. Maybe I'm just apathetic altogether and I'm just kind of checked out anyway. So every reason why there's not conflict is the reason why to think, you know, that your culture is probably not as healthy as it should be.
And then I go back to continuous improvement, because it's very complacent to have really calm meetings, so to speak. Like, we need to do a better job of looking for, you know, mining for conflict is a term I've heard in the market out there. So continuous improvement plays a big part in that, of, you know, evaluating, are we just stagnant, you know, and if not, we got to do something about that.
Yeah, you mentioned some of the things that define workplace culture for you. You mentioned continuous improvement, like you just said. Constructive conflict is what you call it, because there can definitely be the other kind, which is not healthy. Yeah. But you also mentioned two other things, integrity and reliability. So expand on those for a little bit.
Well, I think integrity is probably, it's got to be number one. You have, it's a, there's no compromise on that. You have to treat others like you want to be treated. You have to have that integrity, and you have to be consistent with it across the board. If not, I don't care how good your culture is, you're not going to keep people, and you're probably not going to keep and attract customers in the end. So it's just, that's probably as simple as you could say. You got to have integrity to do that. Reliability to me, and there are studies on this. Duke University did a study on this, and they asked customers of service companies, what are the most important attributes of a good service company? And Scott, overwhelmingly, number one was reliability. Like, you can be professional, you can be courteous, you can be responsive. All of those are really good things. And there's actually 10 of them, but it doesn't matter if you're not reliable. So reliability, just quite simply, is doing what you say you're going to do. And probably speed has a lot to do with that as well. So going back, you could have conflict in a meeting and have really good ideas, but if you're not going to do what you say you're going to do, which is the next step, you either don't have a next step, or if you're not reliable, then that thing doesn't get off the ground. You know, again, I go back to the school. If we didn't reach out to other schools that were out there to learn what some of the challenges are and what's that, we probably wouldn't, Legacy probably wouldn't be here today. So reliability is a really important piece to the puzzle.
What's the future of healthcare look like? Because it's changing all the time, and it's always a topic of, I would say, conflict, right? There's so many views on healthcare and how it should be handled. And I don't know if it'll ever be solved. It's changing all the time. So
yeah.
What does it look like to you?
There's a lot of complexities, you know, to healthcare. I think technology is going to have some sort of play in there, whether it's making access easier or increasing the speed of information, you know, to that clinician. I think there's going to need to be collaboration amongst a lot of different providers working together, because I don't see the workforce rapidly increasing enough to what the need is going to be. So there's going to be some really sharp folks out there looking at ways to meet it. I think in general, though, I think healthcare is going to happen more frequently in the house than in a brick and mortar place. That doesn't mean hospitals and other, you know, brick and mortar healthcare facilities, if you will not exist. They will, but there's going to be more focus inside the house. And a lot of that is non-medical in nature. You know, it's environmental safeties and family dynamics and those kinds of things. So I'm really interested in, you know, senior run care kind of being part of that table, even again, being non-medical in nature. We've got a lot of knowledge in this industry of what it looks like in a side of house, because we're currently there for long periods of time. And so there's data there. We just got to figure out how it talks to the medical community as well. And that's happening right now. So It'll be interesting to see how some of these partnerships go. But, you know, I think we're all going to be more aware, and I think we kind of already are, of our own healthcare, and then doing something about it. So more of that preventative side.
Do you think COVID sped up this home-based idea that you're having?
Absolutely. You know, I think, honestly, I think we all kind of felt what it may feel like when we're, you know, older in age, so to speak, because we couldn't leave our house and we, you know, couldn't see a lot of people and those kinds of things. So we got a feeling of that. But yeah, you know, a lot of places were closed. We weren't allowed to go into certain places. And so I hope that another pandemic doesn't come back by any means. But I think people are interested now in being home more, so to speak. You know, you talk about remote work and those kinds of things. I think just in general, we're all looking personally at our houses as, you know, more of a home base, you know, a settled place. So yeah, I think COVID absolutely sped that through. And, you know, as terrible as COVID was to our society and the effects it had, you know, we started looking at for ways to be better, to be a better stewards of healthcare, and having more access and being quicker and getting in the home. And it looked pretty clunky to begin with, but it's only going to be, I think, better for folks down the road.
Yeah. How was, so you're a home-based business. COVID probably put a pretty big damper on that in some way, shape or form, right? But there were things that people needed where you were needed to go into those homes and operate in some normalcy, right? So yeah. How did you operate during COVID? What changed? And then what has stuck? What has remained, even though restrictions start to come down now? We're starting to live life a little bit more normal. What did you learn from that? And then what's kind of stuck around since that point?
Man, there's a lot we learned, and learned that, you know, we can do better. You know, technically we're a remote company, right? Cause we're not in, an office. Our workforce is out in the field, but boy, we still needed to look for ways to be better when it comes to a communication standpoint. I think it was probably the number one, getting the word out, getting updates, because I still remember those first couple of hours, much less days, just information was changing and moving so quickly. And as a business, you had to react to certain changes that were happening out there. And so I would say that was the big one, how the importance of our communication and how we deliver it is really, really important. And then the second one, I think we undervalued, if you will, the face-to-face connection. It's just so much more efficient to be together in a group. There's so many organic things being communicated and solved. Even though we can do this over Zoom, I can send you a text message or an email, it's still not fast enough, in my opinion, to just the human interaction, which is pretty neat. So that has stuck, if you will, in the sense that, you know, we're being more open to remote, flexibility for office teams. We've continued to try and find ways to improve engagement with our communication out, whether it's training or recognition and those kinds of things, which I think is a really great thing. And it's really put a value on, like, as an example, we have monthly get-togethers at the office, you know, and boy, those are, people are really excited about that, you know, because it's our time to see our teams together. You know, our caregivers are out in the field, like coming in and bringing our clients in. So, you know, it's obviously it's a safe environment, and that's fun. But you know, during COVID, we were really able to leverage our school and get supplies, safety supplies for our teams, and so that really helped us quickly rebound and support more people. So, but I just can't think you can undermine, you know, how important communication is, and that's such a general word, but really honing in on what are the messages that we're getting out and that we need to get out, and how.
So valuable. And those are things that weren't new because of COVID. Like good communication and face-to-face interaction was not new because of COVID. And I think what you're saying and what I think a lot of us have experienced is COVID heightened our awareness of the importance of these things and how we really need to put an emphasis on them in order to stay healthy, both individually, as families, and as a society, as a community, as a business, like all facets of that. How important those things really are and how much we need to value them, because, you know, we take them for granted sometimes. It's really important that we learn to value those things.
Yeah. You know, one area that has helped us is improving the quality of our service, for our clients. And we're always, again, continuous improvement, always trying to get better at that. I don't know if you heard the book, Hug Your Customer. It's one of my favorite books. And in there, the gentleman says, and he's a high-end clothier on the East Coast. And every time they're trying to exceed that client expectation, try and just do something that blows them away. And he says, you know, every year, if our customer ranks our quality of service an 11 out of a 10-point scale, that's really good for that year. But come January 1st, that 11 automatically drops to a 7, because now that's where the minimum, that's where the bar, that's where the expectation is. And so every year, we got to be looking at ways to upping our game and improving that experience. And you know, those are some of the things that our caregivers have been asking about, you know, like what are some more activities that we can do with our clients and those kinds of things to really, you know, improve that experience during COVID, because we're in this house. What are some creative things that we can do? And so that was really neat to see. And again, I don't know how quickly that would have gotten back to the office in the past, you know, because we would wait for them to come in the office, as an example. So again, totally agree with you that two-way communication is so important.
Patrick, I love your twist on the business aspect of what you, the training thing has stuck with me ever since our first conversation, the school, and the way you use that, not only for retention, but also for recruitment purposes, and to, because it's open to outside individuals, right? I mean, you don't have to work at your company in order to go to this school, correct?
That's correct. So about 10% maximum of students who go through that program are employees of Senior One Care. So 90% of it is going out into these fields. And during COVID, they were essentially the front lines in the nursing homes. So it's a really neat, you know, group of instructors that, again, are making an impact in a different way.
So how can people get in touch with you? They want to talk more about this. Maybe they're interested in talking more about becoming a caregiver in some way, shape, or form, or they just want to hang out with you because you're awesome.
Yeah. Well, the best way to get a hold of me is through LinkedIn. You know, I'm fairly active there. So check me out there. Our website, senioronecare.com, has a great blog there. If you're looking to help, need resources, just information, education about taking care of a loved one or what I should be thinking about. Great on that aspect. It's also some good tips for some of our caregivers that are out there. If you want to become a caregiver, website's a great place to go check it out. But I would just tell people, just be more aware out there that there are folks that need some assistance, and it doesn't take a lot to make a difference in someone's life. So even if it's just a small act of kindness, you don't know how far that can go to take care of somebody. And if you really like people, Scott, I would love to talk to you, because I think you'd make a really good caregiver out here, because we need it. We need it.
I don't know about that. You'd have to ask my kids. That's my kids. Well, thanks, Patrick. It was so fun having you on here, man. It's good talking to you again, and good luck up there.
Oh, thanks, Scott. I appreciate it.
You see what I'm talking about? The idea of this school, just the idea of it, speaks to, one, being innovative, thinking outside the box about how you can not only, educate your own people, but also work on recruitment and retention at the same time. And it's just really, really smart business model wise. So very cool that he brought that up. His heart, though, you can tell that going from where he was in sales and marketing, then becoming a caregiver for his mother-in-law, and then saying, hey, there's something else here for me. There's a bigger piece of me that the world needs. And by training other people to care for others, he is able to not only multiply himself, but cause them to then multiply what they have to the other people that they're serving. Because like he said, some of these people that work there are going on to be nurses and going on to do other things in the medical profession. And if he's able to play a small part in their role of growing into that capacity, then all the better. And he is proud of that. Integrity is a big thing for Patrick. It should be for all of us. Continuous improvement. We spoke about that multiple times. Super, super cool. Constructive conflict. We talked about the idea of, hey, wait a second, turnover? People hate turnover. Now, I'm sure he doesn't love a ton of turnover, right? But the right kind of turnover, the turnover that says, hey, you're going on to grow and be something better because you were here. That's pretty cool to be able to look at it that way. And then to think about the constructive conflict and the way that that helps us all grow and refine who we are, because we are safe enough to bring up that conflict. That's where real growth happens. That's where true liberation happens. So Patrick, thank you for being on the show today. If y'all want to find out more about me, you can go to scottwaldron.com, and my shows are there. Some other services that I provide there about team training, communication, culture development is all there. If you want to subscribe to my YouTube channel, please do like, comment, subscribe, all those things, because I want to get the word out, and I have some free tools on there that can help you in your own leadership journey. And connect with me on LinkedIn, because I am there quite a bit, and I offer some free resources for you there as well. So thanks again for being here on another episode of Unlocked, and we'll see you next time.